Now, the
Now,
bigger issue with the NFA is an issue of trust. It's an agency that's been riddled with corruption. It has a checkered past. I mean, you heard RG Cruz's report just recently, right? You had NFA employees who were suspended and they sold a stock and then now they're going back to work. So this is the kind of culture that's perceived to be in the NFA. It's a culture of corruption. So you don't have senators supporting empowering the NFA again. What can be done? So that's where the dead end is.
Before I answer that question, Karen, I want to make it clear that I have nothing against rice importation. We live in a global economy, and of course, ang importation ay bahagi na talaga ng buhay natin, whether we like it or not. But we cannot continue with importation while neglecting our local farmers. Ang mahalaga dito is to empower them and make them competitive. So answering your question is a question of trust for our dear senators. So what is their option? Yun ang tanong ko. Sana mapag-usapan nila, and I hope pag umakyat na po ang aming panukalang batas, which is on second reading, at next week is the third reading na po ang aming amendments sa Rice Certification Law, they would seriously consider our suggestions. Dahil nagdaan po kami sa napakaraming oras ng pagdinig dito sa mga amendments na to. And of course, we recognize and we realize that trust is an important issue, especially sa pag carry out ng mandate ng NFA. So I think the senators should also come up with an option. So if they do not trust the NFA, binanggit ng chairperson ng Agricultural Committee sa Senado, Senator Saint Villar, maybe the president would want to have that power. But we'll leave it up to them to discuss kung ano ang kanilang alternative. Pero sa ganang amin sa Kongreso, nais namin sanang empowering NFA. If we have to weed out corrupt officials within the NFA, let's do it. But there is also a presumption of regularity sa ating mga government agencies. Kung hindi natin pagkakatiwalaan natin mga sariling government agencies, eh saan tayo pupulutin? Hindi tayo uusad. So if we have to weed them out, let's weed them out. But inaasahan namin at nakikiusap kami sa mga senador to consider the amendments that we have made in the lower house. Dahil ito ay produkto ng aming pakikipag-unayan sa mga magsasaka. We've heard them out. We've also talked to consumer groups. We've talked to economists, to experts in the field. And this
and
is
do,
what
do they all agree that the NFA should be empowered again?
Yes.
All these people, the stakeholders you've spoken with?
Mostly, yes.
Okay. Now, if the House bill is enacted, another revision is, and we can discuss this, is the Agriculture Secretary can recommend, this is upon the recommendation of the National Price Coordinating Council or the Local Price Coordinating Council, the Agriculture Secretary can declare a food security emergency due to following reasons: a shortage in supply of rice, a sustained increase in the price of rice, an extraordinary increase in the price of rice. But at this point, can't the president do that? I mean, unilaterally as it is.
Yes, the president would also have to consult with the agricultural secretary because it is the mandate of the agriculture department to monitor prices and to see how things are going in the market. So upon the recommendation, I think, of the agricultural secretary, the president can declare an emergency.
Okay. What about, we talked about rice subsidy, and we know that the common discussion is often, it's all about going on market prices, supply and demand, right? Even Representative Stella Kimbo, parang they call it basic economics, right? That subsidy isn't essentially good. But then, for example, you have other countries that subsidize power because power is a staple, right? So then you have more foreign investors coming in. The thing with rice is it's also a staple. So subsidizing the price of rice so that there's an option. Yung tinatawag na NFA rice, nanoon nga 27, 29 pesos. So the poorest of the poor can buy that rice. Is that out of the equation already, Representative Roman? Because like now in
Well,
Indonesia, I'm looking right now, there is a subsidy program for what they call poor to near poor households. The subsidy of those of the rice that's sold to them is roughly 7 to 80% below the market price. So there is rice subsidy in other ASEAN countries for the extremely poor.
Yes, Karen, actually, there are several programs run by the DSWD that subsidize food for the poorest of the poor. In fact, just yesterday, we were discussing in the House a legislative measure that would actually institutionalize food stamps for those who are considered to be poorest of the poor. This does not have to be necessarily reflected, I mean, in the amendments to the rice tariffication law, because as we said, we want to respect the market forces of supply and demand. So in order for us to subsidize, marami naman programa ang DSWD.
Uh-oh. But the problem is, if you give them the money, they may not buy the rice. So let's say, and this is just a discussion, if NFA rice is sold at hypothetically 29 pesos, the market price is 40 pesos, 50 pesos, 60 pesos, and you don't subsidize at 29 peso per kilo, tutulungan mo sila with a food stamp. They still can't afford the 40 pesos per kilo to 50. Am I making sense?
Yes.
Instead of the very poor knowing, may NFA rice eh. Ang presyo doon 20. This was, remember what President Marcos Jr. was in effect doing with Maharlika? But it was not widespread enough, right? So with Maharlika, not Maharlika, Masagana of President. Masagana is in effect, the price of rice there was lower. Technically, that was the old NFA rice.
Mm-hmm. So, Karen, the nature of subsidy is they actually do not cover the entire expense of a family. You cover it partially. Pangtulong lang yan, pangdagdag. Yan ang nature natin ng subsidy. So we do not actually expect to cover the entire food expense of a family with a subsidy. I know it may sound a little, no? But this is another way of encouraging families to be responsible in management of their finances, whether kahit na medyo limited ito. Pero ganun talaga ang subsidy. Hindi tayo nagko-cover ng 100%.
Oh, hindi naman yun, pero ibig sabihin sa revisions na ito, mawawala na po yung dati na alam natin na NFA rice. Kasi we are giving them more power, right? They can procure. Mm-hmm. So it's for buffer stocking. Pero noon kasi may NFA rice, iba ang presyo niya. And yes,
mas mababa. Generally, mas mababa ang NFA rice.
And it's in a subsidy of 9 pesos per kilo then. Right? So yan ang tanong ko, because the NFA would buy palay from farmers at a much higher gate price. Kumbaga, hindi doon kumikita yung farmer, hindi sila tinatawaran nung middleman. Pag binili ng NFA, yung farm gate mas mataas. Hindi ba ganun? Isn't that what you're imagining? Isn't this bill?
What we're imagining is that the NFA would buy the production, local production, to save our farmers
at a good price,
para hindi malugi ang ating, not necessarily very high. Not as much as the farmers would want to earn, but definitely much better than the conditions being provided for by middlemen. Okay, so with that, pag nakabili ang NFA from our local farmers, ang problema ngayon na na-encounter natin is that there is always cheaper rice because imported. So, ang naging reklamo ng ating mga consumers is that bakit ganun? Parang mas mura pa ang bigas na imported, no? Kesa locally produced palay. All right. Now, how do you solve the situation? Okay.
Yeah.
The solution is to increase the buffer stock para merong tayong leeway para makapag-compete tayo sa presyo ng imported rice. So ganun ang ating layunin. Ano?
So you believe it, because I think the buffer stock was 9 days, right? Mm-hmm. Is it the minimum of 9 days? Are you increasing the buffer stock?
Yes, I think. yung buffer
For what,
stock,
for weeks? And you think that would make a difference in the price in the market?
yes, that would also contribute. That would
Oh,
contribute.
okay. All right. Well, this is still on second reading, so we can
Second
discuss
and
this at
reading.
length.
Next week, third reading now.
Yeah, and before we go, I want to talk to you about the SOGI bill. So, what is the update on the SOGI bill? You are the prime advocate of the SOGI bill. And what are the biggest challenges, do you believe, other than you do have some lawmakers, especially in the Senate, who are against it? But why are we struggling to pass this? It's been languishing in Congress for years, considering that President Marcos Jr. issued an executive order back in December creating a special committee for the LGBTQIA plus. Okay, has that helped? Has that helped at all?
In terms of representation, it has helped. The Special Committee for LGBTQIA Affairs. It is a statement made by the executive that recognizes the importance of this community and its determination to eradicate discrimination within the executive. Pero it's not enough because what we need is a national law to protect members of the LGBTQ plus community from discrimination at the workplace, in learning institutions, in the delivery of government services, in public establishments, and in the use of public accommodations, no? So ang nangyayari, Karen, meron tayong 77 LGUs with anti-discrimination ordinances, especially in big cities, but we do not have a national law, which begs the question if local government units are capable of recognizing this need to fight discrimination, bakit hindi namin kaya sa national level? Kami naman sa House of Representatives, widespread ang support eh. Ito nga ang diferensya, Karen. Ano? I don't want to make comparisons, but it seems that kami, because we are directly engaging with our constituents and we feel the clamor and the need for an anti-discrimination law, we respond in the House of Representatives. We are not very theoretical. We are not detached from the day-to-day lives of our constituents. And this is also the same working principles that we have applied with the amendments to the rice tarification law. Alam mo, Karen, itong rice tarification law, at bunga na rin ang aming pakikipag-uusap sa napakaraming farmers. The principal authors, we have an economist, Representative Stella Kimbo. We also have a Harvard graduate, ano, si Representative Micaela Swansing, who is from Nueva Ecija. And there's the wealth experience of the entire rice industry. Alam mo naman, rice granary ang Nueva
Okay.
Ecija. And
Uh-oh.
ito ang aming prinsipyo, no? We try to respond. At sana, ang pananawagan ko sa ating mga senador, maging sensitive sila sa pangangailangan ng ating mga mamamayan. You know, we can
Okay.
be very theoretical about things and criticize, but we should also provide concrete alternatives. Like if there's a trust issue with the NFA, ano ang inyong alternative? Open naman
Okay.
tayo dyan.
Balikan lang natin very quickly, should the president already certify the SOGI bill as urgent? Because clearly he supports it, but he's not certifying it as urgent.
I would want him to certify it, but I do realize that there are other issues that are more urgent, like the prices of our basic commodities like rice, the increase in the prices of utilities like water, electricity, ang ating mga problema sa transportation sector, yung jeepney modernization, also yung sitwasyon ng ating mga, for example, ang ating mga barangay health workers as well, ng ating mga yung ating pension system and more importantly yung ating health system, no, with the full implementation of the Universal Health Care Act. Those are very important because it's a matter of life and death, which is not to say na hindi importante ang pagkilala sa dignidad at karapatan ng mga Pilipino, kasama na dyan ang LGBTQ plus community, Karen.
All right. On that note, I want to thank you for joining me today, Bataan Representative Geraldine Roman. Thank you so much. And I do hope you can update us on the revisions to the rice tarification law.
We will, Karen. Thank you very much for taking interest. Mabuhay kayo.